Master Reddit. Subscribe for more videos.
What is something that really freaks you out on an existential level? What percentage of my life do I even remember? My childhood is a dim memory, but so are many average days of my adult life. Keep a diary. Even a few notations in a day planner can bring back a wealth of memories, even of the vaguest days. This was said a million times, but there was a time where you played outside with your childhood friends for the last time and none of you even knew it. When I'm traveling by plane in a different country and I'm looking down to the ground and see cars, buses and everything driving around on the countryside or a city, and I think to myself, down there is people living life exactly like I do and doing their everyday thing. Makes me think how big the world actually is and how tiny you are as a person. That freaks me out a bit. It's one of the things I've really enjoyed about moving to another country. I've been here 6 years now and everyone does the same stuff as at home. They go get groceries, they make dinner, they meet up with friends at the weekend, they get annoyed and frustrated because the dog shat on the rug again. It's all the same stuff. But then there are also minutiae that are different. No pub quizzes here, people eat at restaurants more often, there's e-bikes everywhere. We're all people, all the same, but there's also differences in how people live. It's hard to explain. Practical upshot is, whenever I see a news story about any other country, I feel very aware that whatever is happening there is affecting these same people on the street. I feel like I no longer see other countries as other countries, but communities as rich and detailed and complex as mine, just that I haven't lived there yet. Weirder yet, this goes all the way back into history. We learn about the big events like wars and technological breakthroughs, but while Caesar was pontificating over which land to conquer next, some normal guy in a tunic was having a shitty evening because the bathhouse he went to has changed their wine supplier due to a falling out with the old supplier, and now he's pissed off because he really liked the wine they used to serve here and you couldn't get it anywhere else, and now he's got to drink this new stuff. And we'll never know that guy's name, or the name of the bathhouse, or the wine, or the supplier, but you can bet that hundreds of people had thoughts, opinions about each of them. This post got a bit longer than I anticipated, but yeah. Zonda is fascinating. That the tiniest, most inconsequential decision can completely change the entire course of your life. Nearly 20 years ago, I needed some new shoes for work. As a poor student, I got the cheapest pair I could find. 2 days later, I was supposed to be going straight from work to a club with my friends when, halfway through my shift, the sole half ripped off one of the shoes. I didn't have enough time to get home, change my shoes and get back to work before everyone left for the club, so I just went home and gave it a miss. That night, I started chatting with someone on a forum. A year later, went to visit them in America. 2 years later, I moved to America and we got married. 10 years after that, we both moved back to the UK. Had I chosen a different pair of shoes, I'd never met my wife, never moved to America, and my life would be completely different now. Because shoes. Guess you could say she's your soulmate. I probably won't be remembered. On a long enough scale, none of us will. Chimpanzees. I have never really been able to articulate this as well as I would like, but the existence of chimpanzees is deeply disturbing to me in a very indescribable fashion. They're basically us except for a few very minor and completely random mutations that made us slightly better at analyzing patterns and communicating with each other. Whenever I see a chimpanzee, I'm really confronted with the fact that we humans are just another animal species, mostly controlled by instinct and making our decisions based on an incredibly biased framework of sensory perception and mental processing that was developed to survive a hunter-gatherer lifestyle on the African savanna. Did you know that to show submission to the leader of their pack, chimpanzees will come before him and bow to show their respect? That blew my mind because humans have been bowing to their leaders since. Since we had leaders. And we can invent all kinds of justifications for it. He's descended from the gods, he led our armies to victory over the foreign barbarians, I agree with his views on tax policy. But at the end of the day, we're just apes bowing before another ape who groomed us well enough to become the pack leader. That is so fucking disturbing to me, I can't even describe it. I work at a zoo and the only animal that kinda creeps me out are the chimps. I remember I spent about 30 minutes straight just watching them and how they behave. It's very human-like in a lot of ways. I remember it was raining and the baby chimp was sticking out his tongue and catching raindrops. That was something I did as a child too. It was mind-blowing in a small way. Wait and see if you ever get a chance to work with bonobos. They basically are human minus civilization. Sigh. I hate to be the one that says this, but I've done animal behavior work in zoos, specifically with bonobos, and they're violent little shits. Franz de Waal is nearly solely responsible for this highly romanticized view of bonobos, and later on in his research he notes that the peaceful nature of bonobos has been way overstated. And no, it's not that bonobos in captivity are tweaking out. In the wild they're even more violent. Bonobos are danged interesting and they do have social structures different from chimps, but the effectiveness of sex to diffuse tensions has been wildly overstated. Bonobos can and will eat your fucking fingers off if they feel like it. Unpopular bonobo males get the shit kicked out of them by everyone else and it feels like every other day Bria ape needs major stitches because he's just covered in bite marks. Bonobo females do run shit, but it's not like they do it super peacefully. Don't get me wrong. I loved my time working with bonobos and I think they're amazing. But they're dicks, and the misinformation about them is ridiculous. Are they very human-like? Yes. Because humans are often dicks. How you can trace the whole path of your life to some small, seemingly inconsequential event. Decades ago, when I was new to this area, I met a guy on the golf course and we became friends. I met others through him, and now 90% of my friends and contacts can be traced back to that meeting. If I had not golfed that day, or got one extra red light on the way to the course, would I have a whole separate set of friends now? I accepted a random FB friend request from some Australian guy 8 years ago and now I live in Australia and am marrying him in a few weeks. And to think, I almost denied that friend request. That whatever I did in the past are now just memories. Even yesterday. Even though sometimes it feels like my childhood just happened, it was 20 years ago in their memories. Did those actions even happen? It's hard to explain the feeling. My dad died 21 years ago. It was well before the age of camera phones and he really didn't like having his picture taken regardless. As a result, I have maybe 2 pictures of him. I think I still have a mental picture of him but sometimes I'm not so sure. He was one of the most significant people in my life and his death is one of the most significant events in my life but honestly, there's a good chance that if he walked up to me today, I wouldn't recognize him. This hits me hard. My dad died very suddenly and unexpectedly a little over 4 years ago. It messed me up a lot more than I ever imagined it would. I also carry the weight of being the only person who knows what really happened on the day that he died. I let my family believe that it was a lot more peaceful than it really was because knowing the truth would only upset them further and wouldn't serve any purpose. I still see people who look like him and for that brief second my brain recognizes my dad before remembering that he is dead. I can still see his face clearly and hear his voice even. Luckily I have quite a few pictures of him. Also I recently discovered a short recording of his voice quite by accident that really kind of messed me up. He was even saying my name. I'm so sorry that your memories have faded and you don't have any pictures to refresh them. The thought of forgetting my dad's face is terrifying to me so I'm very thankful that I have as many pictures as I do. I know it doesn't mean much but I'm sending my internet hugs your way. I get this, especially when it relates to childhood. Like, anything before maybe 10 years old. I know there is science about forming long-term memories in development and whatnot. But what did I do? If I think, I can remember some flashes like scenes from a flashback montage or something, but so many hours, days, years that I don't have a clue how to answer what I did then. Yup. I actually thought about this when I was maybe 8. I was walking behind my parents down the street to their friend's house. I was bored and thought about how bored this walk was and what a waste of time. I wish we would have drove. Then I just started thinking about how many random boring moments there are in life that are just forgettable. So I decided that I was going to remember this moment, forever. The random walk that is totally forgettable I will remember forever. And some 30 plus years later, when I think about memories or random moments I think back to that random walk when I was 8. How much quicker time goes by as you get older? Remember when you were 5, and a summer vacation felt like a whole lifetime? I just want to be a kid again. Life is like a roll of toilet paper. The closer you get to the end the faster it goes. The fact that I will never know how things turn out. What becomes of the world once I'm gone. I only understand life as the version I've lived. I never get to know the future. It is frustrating being capable of absorbing the long view when it comes to the story of our planet and species while also being keenly aware that my lifetime will end before getting a glimpse of where the human race will take all the potential we have. Most of all, I just wish I could know whether we can collectively solve or at least ameliorate on a global scale the huge problems that face us. Don't worry, the end game is heat death of the universe. Similarly, you'll never truly know what happened in the past. Even your own memories can't be trusted, and the further away you get from that point in time you remember, the less reliable it is. I read a psychology report that says every time you remember an event, and then remember it again, you are no longer accessing memories of the event, but the memory of the last time you remembered it, thus losing clarity and detail each time you recall. How we could die at any second. Today, tomorrow, in a week, in the next 5 minutes, and nobody can stop it. Death is one of the true guarantees of life. I'm not sure what's worse, knowing you're dying, or dying without knowing it. My entire life, my DRS have told my parents and myself that my time on Earth is more limited than most. I was born with 5 congenital heart defects and 2 congenital lung defects. I was 10 hours old with my first open heart surgery. I was born literally dying. I was blue and wasn't breathing. It was a complete shock that I was sick at all. This was almost 30 years ago, so we didn't have the technology to pick it up like they can now. My DRS can't say how I'm still alive. I shouldn't be. I'm definitely more limited and have been my whole life. Along with having COPD, one working lung, pulmonary hypertension heart, pulmonary fibrosis, heart failure, AFib, 2 strokes and a heart attack, etc. I know what dying feels like. With my 4th open heart surgery, I was 15. I was dying. This OS was a huge risk. I would have died without it, but it also carried a big high chance I wouldn't make it off the table. My mom told me that if I wanted to, I could go ahead and go forward, or decide not to do it. She knew I had to have a say. I hate when I hear people talking about young adult and kids who are chronically ill, that they aren't in the mindset of picking the right thing and wanting to live. That they can't know what life can be like. Sometimes death isn't the worst thing to happen. And unless you've personally lived through something where you're very sick, you can't talk to this situation. For me, there is no right answer here. Even though I was dying and things were really bad, the morning of my 4th open heart surgery, I wanted to walk to the hospital. My check-in time at the hospital was about 6:30 a.m. I believe. All my DRS are in Chicago, and this was before Children's moved downtown. Ronald McDonald House was about 3 blocks from Children's Memorial Hospital. It was slightly raining, and still somewhat dark, but I knew it could have been the last time I was outside. So instead of calling the shuttle to the hospital, my mom let me walk, and left with enough time to do so, and had my wheelchair with us so I had the choice. A few days before this surgery, I got things together. I left letters to certain people in my life. I wrote down what I wanted certain people to have. Of the dresses I had in my closet, I pinned a note to one of them, letting my mom know I picked it to be buried in my death dress. I was only 15 then. It was very hard to do this. But I wanted to have some closure and peace. Thankfully, they didn't need to be used. I'm almost 30 now. I'm slowly dying. Most my life is spent in bed. I'm greatly limited in what my body lets me do. It's hard knowing what I have will most likely kill me. It's not easy either way. It's nice to have things set aside for your loved ones for after you die. But not having to think about your death would be nice too. Neither is easy. Edit: even though I'm not sure how many more people will see this, I still want to try. Next week is 12 years since my 4th open heart surgery. This was the one I'd picked my death dress beforehand. I had the idea in trying to get Google to make a Google Doodle in raising awareness for congenital heart defects. I started it over a year ago, nothing happened. So because of this and the timing, I want to try this again. Here's the link to the Google Doc. It explains everything. CHD is the number one birth defect worldwide, yet for some reason it's hard to get people to share posts that I and others in the CHD world make about CHD. Please help. Please share, heart. Thank you for your comment. It's given me a lot to consider. I am also chronically ill, but I'm told that my lifespan won't be shortened by it. It's more that I live in near constant discomfort and or pain. You've defied the odds before, so I'm hoping with the bottom of my heart that you get another good 30. It takes a, admittedly microscopic, amount of time for your brain to process every stimulus that you receive. This means that you are never perceiving reality in real time. There's the slightest delay between reality and your perception of it. What's worse is that your brain lies to you and tries to trick you about it. Find a clock with a second hand. Look away. Now look right at it. See, the second hand takes just a little longer to move that first second than all the other seconds that come after? That's because your first glimpse of the hand moving is blurry. So your brain waits for it to be in focus, copies that frame, and pastes it backwards instead of the blur. Your brain literally pauses time to make things look how you'd expect it to look. If it's lying about that, what else is it lying about? Every so often I'll see myself in a mirror and am reminded that I am a conscious person able to influence the world around me. Sometimes I get so hung up on the daily routines and the little challenges here and there that I forget that I am a mind connected to a physical body. It's fucking surreal for a few seconds, but then I realize that it's always been like this. Edit, thank you for the gold. I totally did not think this happened to other people. The thing that fucks me up is not that I'm a conscious person, but everyone else too. They're not machines that will react the same way to the same thing every time. Things I say may hurt them. Something I do might annoy them. Sometimes I get lost in it and sit on the lounge with my wife, looking at her thinking, she's having millions of thoughts too. She's remembering different stuff to me, she's making plans. Weird shit, yo. That every public institution, every province of government, every law of any nation, it all works because a sufficiently high percentage of people silently assent that it does. It doesn't matter what type of government is in place, if 70% of the population woke up tomorrow and decided that currency has no value and governance is unnecessary, that's exactly what would happen. Power resides where men believe it resides. I've thought a lot about this, too. Like how many people on the front line of a war really want to be there, and why? What if all the soldiers in the world one day just said, fuck this, threw down their weapons and went home? Or think of the places with rampant homelessness while houses are sitting empty being repossessed. How does that make any sense? The term you're looking for is intersubjectivity, I think. A book you might be interested in is Sapiens by Yuval Noah Harari. There is a section in his book that discusses this, very interesting stuff. To sum it up in short, hunter-gatherer groups were most efficient in certain numbers, can't remember specifics. I think the sweet spot was around 150, when the agricultural revolution came and humans began to be in communities much larger than hunter-gatherer groups. They had to create social systems that allowed said communities to thrive in such large numbers, the most effective being essentially myths that they all agreed on, which is what you have said. Sorry I've explained this poorly, I recommend the book. This thread. Thanks for the multi-tiered existential crisis at work. Boss, is that report going to be done by 3? Me, what does it matter? Words and numbers. They have no meaning except what our brains provide. And us? We're just two bags of meat and bones and blood, blowing air through our throat holes, making sounds at each other. And you're literally walking around with a sack of shit inside of you. So am I. So is everyone here. We are on the 8th floor of a 15-story building. All day there is shit raining down around us from the floors above. This building is a giant cascading tower of shit, all day long. Boss, why don't you forward that report to me before sending it out? Might be best if I give it a quick review. Knowledge lost. Societies that existed millennia before ours had incredibly complex social structures, massive infrastructure, built incredible wonders, understood boggling amounts of modern math, and did it all in harsher conditions with less technology. So clearly they were smart and capable, at least some. Imagine all the great knowledge that they had which we lost. All the theorems or observations they made in societies that lasted 10 times as long as many of today's, which disappeared in war or accident. Knowledge defines man. We are a species of filers, who wish to make pattern and sense out of chaos. Yet knowledge is so very fragile. It messes me up that people 1,000 years ago were just as capable to learn what we are now. A kid from early Rome could go to school in 2018 and be just as smart as everyone else. Not only is knowledge fragile, but in some cases, it may even be unobtainable. In a trillion years or so, the expansion of the universe will progress to the point where it becomes physically impossible to detect the light from other galaxies. So much of what we know about the history of the universe has come as the result of studying other galaxies, and once they finally disappear beyond the cosmic horizon, all of the insights they carry with them will vanish forever. If any civilization is just emerging at that time, they'll have no way to know that the universe is expanding, or what it was like in the past. They will be completely isolated on a single galactic island, with no hint that a much larger reality lies beyond what they can see. While they may think they understand the universe that they see around them, they'll never truly have a complete picture. Because we can see this inevitable loss of information coming, it forces us to ask an incredibly uncomfortable question: has fundamental information about the nature of our universe already been lost beyond some unknown cosmic horizon? Could it be that we are fundamentally wrong in our understanding of reality because an important piece of the puzzle has been lost and will never return? Mind-blowing shit. Every time we step outside of our houses could be the time we never come back. At any moment, some freak accident could happen and kill any one of us. Our lives are just an endless stream of consciousness, worrying about our own problems, worrying about this, worrying about that, but it could all come to a screeching halt in a split second, and we'd be gone from the world in an instant. I'm a biker. I think about this every single time I straddle that seat. Every time I put on that helmet. This could be my last ride. That's the risk I take with a hobby that I love. Edit: your responses are incredible, but let me clarify, I ride a motorcycle, not a bicycle. I have a paramedic friend who once told me that, one day, you're going to put our shoes on and someone else will have to take them off. I think about death every time I put shoes on now. I always realize the enormity of the universe when checking my mailbox. Walk down my driveway, mostly zoning out. My mailbox is across the street in the neighbor's front yard for some fucking reason, so I fart across the street. And it's always then that I look up, and see the moon or the stars and just feel hilariously ridiculous. Somehow the enormity of the universe stands out even more to me when I'm pitting it against two spam credit card offers, an excise tax bill, and the grocery store flyer I throw out before even getting back into house. It's just impossible to reconcile. All of the planets known to man fit between me and a space rock. I am a tiny speck, floating on a slightly less tiny speck, hurling wildly through the void of space, and hay bone and pork chops are $1.99 a pound, neat. Edit: hey neat, thanks. Also I guess enormity doesn't mean enormousness like I assumed, so I learned something today. Looking at the old photos of my ancestors that my great uncle left me. I have no idea who any of the people in them are, but a lot of them look kinda like me, or vice versa really. It's fucking weird thinking about all the people who've lived and died and left really no legacy at all. Forgotten. And knowing I'll be forgotten too. Probably less than even 50 years after I die. It's sobering and makes me realize there is really no use trying to live a life I don't enjoy. If I don't like my job, I should quit. If I want to live somewhere else, I should just go there. Tomorrow is guaranteed to no one. In 125 years, there will be an entirely new set of people on this planet. That no matter how much you get to know someone, no matter how much you share your life, learn about them, feel as though you are almost the same person, there will always be an infinite gulf between who you think they are, and who they really are. You cannot know someone else. You can only know your perception of them. Your experience of that person flows through the filter of your personality, your experiences and memories, your biases and intuitions. You don't know them, you know your conception of them. Subjectivity of experience makes truly knowing another person completely impossible. We are all perfectly isolated souls, completely separate from everyone else, desperately reaching out to convince ourselves we aren't really alone. Whenever I look into a mirror for too long, I start to get freaked out that I'm looking at myself, and myself is looking back at me. Then I start to think about how my brain is witnessing itself in an infinite loop. Then I get freaked out and go about my day. That it's a strong possibility I'll be alone with no family by the time I die. All my friends are married and having kids, and I'm just here like veiled. Maybe I'll try dating again. People say life isn't a race, but if you aren't at the same pace as everyone else when they leave you behind for their own lives, then it's not really a race anymore, is it? You just kind of hobble for a decade then cry at intersections when a red light takes too long. Aw, fuck, too real. This thread. Nothing anyone has written is new to me, but seeing it all in one place is overwhelming. Far out in the future, the universe will be cold, dark, and dead. Forever. There's absolutely nothing we, or anything else, can do about it. For an even closer view, the universe is expanding, so someday all the stars will be so far removed from Earth that their light no longer reaches us. Let's say that there are still humans on Earth at that point, and that no records of past scientific discovery has been maintained. They may think that there are no stars, that Earth is completely alone in the universe, with the exception of what we can see in our small galaxy. Now, what if something like that is already happening with our science of the universe? What if there is something that is just out of our reach, something that would change the way that we see the universe forever, but we just cannot grasp it, cannot find it, and never will because it's moved just out of our sight line? If you enjoyed this video, please hit the thumbs up button and comment below letting me know. It helps the channel and lets me create more content just like this. If you do like this type of content, make sure to subscribe and hit the notification bell so you don't miss an upload.